call the meeting to order at 1:10. And if we want to do introductions, Chaz Rudich.
James B. Chaz.
Maggie Malley, Director.
Sandy Small. Evelyn Noyes.
October and December minutes to be approved.
Motion, we accept the minutes of the October and December.
Second.
All in favor?
In the December minutes. And looking back on business that's been done in the last month. One of the main points, as Sandy had proposed, and Evelyn looking at three or four different topics that the Council on Aging might offer a presentation or a program on. Sandy wonderfully and very quickly reached out to the neurologist she had heard. So we have the date of April 24th for a talk by Dr. Postal. And I think the only bit we might need to discuss is where and what time. If we hold it here at the senior center or look to a larger venue.
How are we going to let them know this is happening?
We'll put for the April 24th date, we'll put it in the newsletter, the March-April newsletter.
Mm-hmm.
And we can post it in the daily news.
I talked to while I was working as an elderly senior I mentioned it to Susan Royce, and she mentioned that there are a couple of methods that we could do to improve spreading it out. As in said, we're up on the website, she was willing to help us with that. We could give her the information, which I'd be happy to do. And I can do that even though I'm leaving, I can do that over the email.
Yeah.
She also suggested that it might be a good idea for us if we haven't, do we have any list of our seniors' emails?
We do, we have a fairly discreet list of folks who like to receive the newsletter,
the email.
110 or 40 people.
She suggested doing a blast on that week. And I'd like to back up just a little bit. This presentation, because I've seen it, is about someone that has, if you're caring for an elderly person, you may be worried about dementia. You may be worried yourself, but I'm wondering if we want to also invite family members.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know how many they're going to be able to come at, you know, we suggested, you know, 1 in the afternoon, I don't know how many, but if I was taking care of someone and I was worried, I think it would be a nice thing to, so my thought was, I know that Susan could put it just up on the town website,
right, right,
so that it'd be really, because I would sure hate to have one or two people come. Have this
yeah.
lady coming.
I can do the two housings.
Okay.
But can you send me a...
She has a bio and picture she's offered to send, and perhaps we can set up some kind of a flyer. Would that help? Something like that?
Yeah. We'll put it up at Newbury Village also. And put a flyer in the town clerk's area.
Now, would you utilize that bio in the picture for the newsletter?
We could, you know, depending on its length, look at those, you know, just the main portion of it. Absolutely, put that in the newsletter.
Okay. So how is she going to get this to you?
She'll email it to me.
Okay. So can you email it?
Certainly. I've been trying to pop you guys when I... communicate,
yeah,
so
yeah,
you can see what we're doing,
yeah.
What I'm doing.
That's good.
So you can say, hey, wait a minute, what are you doing?
Yeah.
And she has requested, would we be able to get a jacket?
Through the
school?
Susan, probably the town. I wonder if the town has one, or the library might. So Susan can help us with that, I imagine.
Would
you want to
have it at the library
then? I don't know how we're going to know how many people are coming. How big is that?
If
you sit there.
The room when you first walk into the library and then you take a little to the left,
yeah.
It's not enormous. It's not like an auditorium. It's just a nice meeting room.
Isn't it the size
of
what you have up there? It's a pretty good room.
Pretty much. So are you worried that it will be conspicuous if we don't have a lot of people? I mean, because you can set it up. which
I don't know how we know how many are coming. So how do you prepare for that?
Oh, I see what you're asking.
I mean,
you're thinking that room won't be big enough?
I have no idea.
We could ask for people to call. Oh, it doesn't always work,
yeah.
But we can make the suggestion
yeah,
we'd like to know.
Reserve
a space.
Yes.
You know.
I mean, I don't want to tell them not to come if they haven't reserved.
Right.
But we would like to know
exactly
how much room we need. And we don't want to make a mistake.
But I think the library runs from the fund.
Do the library?
Well,
I think
no,
so
I'm
too. I don't know what the occupancy is, but I think it's a decent
yeah.
sized room.
Yeah.
You know, if there were 10 or there were 50, I think it would
be. Okay.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
And it's in April, so we don't have to worry about traveling in bad weather.
Right.
But we'll have to find out if it's available.
Right. I will. For, say, 1 o'clock on the 24th?
Sounds good to me.
I will reach out to Eugene Echo.
And they just asked Maggie at 99% sure they do have a projector and all that.
I think they do have a nice
one, chairs?
They do.
Oh, yeah.
They do.
Yeah. We'll have to get there early and set up.
Oh, yeah.
Right. What's the other thing I was going to ask? We could utilize the van also to pick people up.
also on the invitation, or whatever you put out there, we can also add family members are welcome.
Any and all are welcome, that's phrased.
Yeah, because it's at 1 o'clock, you know, a lot of people work and not going to be able to work.
And we don't have the capacity for respite, if someone is caring for someone, you know.
But the other thing she mentioned is we could, and I know we hate, but we could video it to put it on.
And then she would post it on the town website, which is a nice idea.
Yeah.
It is. Right.
Yeah, of course.
No, I meant, I did not put it on.
Not simultaneous.
No, I did not do that instead of.
A live stream?
Post it later. Okay, so now.
What is that day?
Is it Thursday? Wednesday or Thursday?
I think it's.
It's a Wednesday.
Yeah, it's a Wednesday.
Now, she's offered to do this free. So do we want to set up some kind of refreshments, coffee or something?
That's a nice idea.
I know this is maybe a little premature, but while I'm on the way, I'd like to try to see what I can do at this point.
I think refreshments is nice. One in the afternoon, we could have cooking some juice or something.
How do we pay for that? Can we just volunteer and bring stuff, or does someone?
We could, the Council on Aging has a discretionary account. It would not be an enormous expenditure.
We could always pay
stuff. We could also see if the friends will cover it as well.
That's actually a fair idea. We post this to the friends at the end of January, there's a meeting, and see if they would be interested. And if we, you know, do two or three more events throughout 2019, if they would pay for light refreshments.
I think for these events. If she is open to individual questions afterwards, that having refreshments is important, because sometimes people like to ask things that they don't necessarily like to ask in public with an audience.
One-on-one meeting?
Yeah, so we have refreshments that can kind of, if she's willing to do that.
Okay, I'll find out.
It's a nice start, thank you.
And I did put a call into a nutritionist, that's why I was looking at my phone, because I reminded her I had a meeting today, but I haven't heard that from her. So I don't know if that's a yes or no for the nutritionist, but more on that later. On my end, and someone else may have already come up with it.
the database, and we talked about that in October also, the database has increased, and the volunteer, the property tax work-off volunteer, has been adding names to the database, the COA database, is almost completed with one block of years, and then she'll go back another few years to make edits and changes, clean up the database. The elementary school did holiday cards for seniors, and from that project, we received probably 30 cards back. It's another nice way of maintaining the database and keeping it current.
So where are we on that, as far as having a list of all the seniors?
The list is ever-evolving as far as people coming off or going on as volunteers, property tax volunteers, adding. She added everyone turning 60 in 2018. Now we get the list for 2019. This again is all data that's generated through the 2010 census numbers.
Mm-hmm. So is a 2018 senior list available to us?
We can identify, we can print out a list depending on what settings we want to put in, so we could print out one specific to the calendar year.
That'd be good.
So when I talked to Susan, I asked her what she had. If you look on the website, they have, if you want to mail you for the newsletter, you have their emails. And also, if you want information from the council, you can get emails. And she has those items. I'm wondering if you have been able to interface those. Or you have those and you are interfacing them?
We receive requests to be placed on the newsletter list, either receive a physical copy or people download them, or to be placed on the email recipients list, electronic. So we do get that through the town website.
Because I think it's important. I know a lot of older people don't use emails. So if we want to get people that are younger seniors, a lot do use emails. So if we can get their email addresses, then Susan says it's really easy for her to send out a blurb email. So we could send out a reminder, you know, to come to that kind of a thing.
And we could do something.
And she's willing to send that out. She's willing to send that out for us as long as we feed her the information.
She's offered that in the past, which is wonderful. We could certainly send out for this event to the recipients list that we currently have.
Yeah.
The electronic.
I think that would be.
Ask, would you like to receive, an update on the next special program?
Yep.
Special
exactly.
Presentation.
Yeah. So I think that's a really great way to get a hold of people if they want to increase the
comment. I think that the predates me by a couple of years, I believe, that the Council on Aging asked residents, I think, through the newsletter, through the newspaper. I don't remember what other way they might have asked. Possibly the town website was very different then. If they would like to receive, if they would prefer to receive,
yes,
the newsletter via email. So the list we have currently was generated from that query.
I don't get mine by email because my other half would never see it.
A lot of people do feel that way.
He doesn't feel that way, he just never looks. Why don't these people send me emails?
Getting back to April 24th, what I would like to see, if it's not too much work to put together, is some sort of a, like a survey. So those that do attend, we could ask them, maybe did you enjoy this
that's an excellent
seminar? What would you like to see in the future? What topics would you like, do you feel important to you? And just see if we can get together something that, if we get any feedback, maybe put together something from their thoughts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's great up there.
Maybe have a box for them to put it there.
That is a good idea.
you want to type up a few things, or you want me to type up a few things for a survey, so we can just look at it over back and forth and see what else to add in there? Okay.
You start it.
Okay, and you can then you guys can
add it in.
See what we should add. Probably don't want it very long.
No.
But we can also ask, give us your email address.
Yeah, I would keep it to no more than 5 questions.
Okay.
Yeah, nice and brief. We have, I'm going to have a copy of the expenditures, which is provided by the assistant treasurer, which is wonderful. She included everything from the beginning of the 2019 fiscal year. So July 1st, 2018, through last Thursday, the 10th of January. You can see each emboldened heading, wages, expenses, and then pages 3 and 4 are different accounts for council and agent has. For example, page 3 is gifts and donations. Page 4 account is the formula grant, which each council and agent receives. It's based on a dollar amount per senior in the town. Again, at this point, it's based on the 1,491 seniors generated from the 2010 census. Newbury utilizes the formula grant and has for a number of years to pay for the outreach case manager.
Does it say on here anywhere the amount donated by the friends?
No, this is not, because their donations are completely separate because they're a 501c3.
Okay.
So their accounting is completely separate.
Getting back to that 2010, as I research things, I find that statistics are not part. Is there a reason, you know, on many other things, that is there a reason that goes back so far? That because they do census every year, right?
They do request every year that you give your updated, you know, like you're still living in this residence, but it's only data is, I'm sure Elder Services uses census figures too, census data, at the 10-year mark.
So but some of the reports I have to do, the housing require that type of information, and whatever, you know, it goes back so far.
It goes back quite a ways, yeah. Yeah, it's true.
So you said the formula grant was based on 1,491 seniors, based on what year was it, 2010?
Yes.
Did I write it
down? Yes, 2010. I mean, it's just in the last published census year. And the dollar amount does change with the number of seniors. Refers back to the last census.
So is that good or bad?
I don't know where we are, and I should ask. Well, we'll be getting a fresh update here and some, but I should ask where we are. The figure that the dollar amount at the moment is $11 an hour for 2018, going up to 12, I believe, for 2019. Times 1,491. So some municipalities, obviously larger municipalities, receive fair amount of money.
So the $11 is the number they use because of the, our other number, the seniors?
No, actually, it's separately independent of that.
Okay, so if we had 10,000, it would still be $11. And how did they arrive at that $11?
The state legislature votes on it. That was the, it's gone up, there were a couple of years that it didn't increase. This year it's going up by $1, which is pretty good.
Does that tie in with minimum wage at all?
I don't think so.
That's going to continue.
I think it's going to.
I think it's 12, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it was going to.
And then increases.
I think they certainly do consider that when they're out with these numbers.
Just wondering.
But I don't think they feel compelled to be held to that. Because it was stagnant for a year or two, so.
So if we had more seniors, we would get more money, is that correct?
Correct.
Oh, so we should probably check.
Well, it's based on the census.
It's based on the census, yeah, we can't.
So we, you know, ideally, we could say we have 14,982 or in our database compared to what the actual census is.
Right, so it's in 2020, we may have gone up to 1,500 or, 1,600. I don't know. But yes, our database will have a different number. And again, we can filter the data that we do have to pull everyone, who turned 60 in 2018, for example, or that's the way I utilized the database for holiday cards, started with 80 and over because we only had a finite number of cards, not enough for every senior over 60 and not every resident over 60. So you can filter and, it's fairly, there's a lot of leeway in what you can pull. Which brings me to, before the data, Gail pulled some data, and I have the example from Townsend, which was great. I mean, that's really good information. The number of residents, 60 plus, total number of seniors, transportation. So Gail pulled a few things. This was 2018, what she had pulled. And this was, for example, Meals on Wheels. She noted that of the 34 names that popped up for the calendar year 2018, constitutes 2,851 meals over the course of the year. People will come on the list, will go off the list, changing number. And likewise with the NEAT program, the Northern Essex Elder Transport Program, 26 clients represents 200 rides in 2018.
So that's not, that has nothing to do with our bus?
No, the NEAT program doesn't. It doesn't. Information on here. Van shopping. 12 participants. It's generated by name. So it's, rotating group of those 12 names for. That's for grocery shopping. For social visits, perhaps coming to the luncheon or doing the luncheon trips beyond Newbury, 39 different people showed up as participating in 2018.
Now that 41 for the outreach, Does that mean 41 people were reached, but not all of them turned into cases, right?
They could have. You know, the 41 are individuals who would have ended up in the database for having received a call from the outreach department mm-hmm. or a visit from the outreach department.
I mean, that's a pretty good number.
It is actually, we talked about that over the last year, that there has been an increase mm-hmm. in outreach requests. While we may not have, we have 7 participants for chair yoga, the outreach numbers have increased some over 2018. Mm-hmm. The flu clinic has also had an increase in 2018. 40 different participants. But that's 41 people who would have generated, who perhaps already have a file, who have received services in the past, or for whom a new file was created, mm-hmm. the new to us, and they have just referred them to other organizations, or Janet may have an ongoing conversation mm-hmm. for periods of time.
Right.
When someone new comes to us, generally it can be 2 or 3 months before they might be receiving services from other services or whatever the request is.
So the outreach program, is there any number one reason people call, or is it just a variety?
It is quite a variety. Housing, but Meals on Wheels, those are 2 off the top of my head reasons. Services, greater services than just meals would probably be the next. Doesn't fall into the category of outreach, but SHINE, just beneath outreach, the Serving Health Information Needs of Everyone, mm-hmm. a volunteer program. We have a counselor who's a volunteer who does hours here. 37 clients in 2018. A number of them are also duplicates. They would have come more than, that's just the individual names, 37 individual names. But oftentimes they will come back a second time, maybe a third time.
So you have a separate person who comes to take care of?
For Medicare mm-hmm. guidance mm-hmm. and counseling. Mm-hmm. That's what the SHINE counselor does specifically. And he's just closed out the open enrollment period of the year, December 7th, I think. And he actually had suggested, as this board had suggested in December, looking at offering programs on different topics. The SHINE counselor in December, at the end of the open enrollment period, suggested possibly looking at doing presentations that he could do, specific to topics that he sees more regularly, questions he receives that he can track.
Yeah.
Related to Medicare, that we can do at 1 o'clock in the afternoon on a Tuesday at the Council on Aging.
Could you couple that, I wonder, with one of your luncheons?
We could. That hasn't been particularly popular in the past.
Okay.
Before me, apparently. That had been tried because it makes good sense. It's practical. But it was not popular.
Yeah. I've heard that they just
want lunch.
Yeah.
No information.
Lunch and socialize,
exactly.
That's it.
No education. So
okay. That's discouraging.
So that's fine. So I thought that you'd be interested in the SHINE counselor, Mark Sullivan.
That would be something good to do before next open enrollment.
Exactly. He thought maybe even quarterly, like we're talking about kind of quarterly doing neurology, nutrition, brain health, nutrition, that he would pick 3, maybe 4 topics before open enrollment starts about the questions that he sees regularly. This is a, you know, folks who are turning 65, you know, throughout the calendar year, who have all of these questions generated, but it would be nice to even do that twice a year, you know. So, so we're going to talk about that this month, later this month when he's here. Just as I didn't print out more than just the copy Gail gave me, the age range in 2018 of people who had reached out for a variety of reasons, 60 to 64 was 3.6% of the total number of people who reached out. The greatest percentage is 85 and over, 31.7% of the total number of people who reached out. And also interesting, and this is probably shows up in the numbers for luncheons and shrine visits. The number of people from out of town, of the total volume of people who reached out for a variety of services, 65.2% are from Newbury, and 34.8% are not. We do have, you know, several programs that anyone is welcome to come. And Shine, residents of any town can go to any council on aging to see a Shine counselor. You know, for example, Newbury has not had, as far as I'm aware, a tax preparation program. But Newbury Port has had one, has put it. Very well-utilized tax preparation program, and they reach out to their neighbors to send people to Newbury Port, so that will show up in their data at the end of the calendar year that they served X percentage of people not from Newbury Port. I think our Shine counselor has a nice reputation, so we do get people from other towns.
What is his name?
Mark Sullivan. He actually fills in the report when they have greater need to try open enrollment when there are more people naturally calling for an appointment. This is the list. Budget. Budget, and I would be happy to email these things also, everyone, if you prefer to do it that way. The budget request for fiscal year 2020, the total is $99,313.73. And includes, that's wages, the only, let's see, miscellaneous, a couple of items related to the phone system, van maintenance, which hadn't been part of the COA budget. The Friends have traditionally paid for van maintenance. I thought it was appropriate to include that in the budget. That we, town department, shouldn't necessarily rely on a nonprofit. And a replacement printer for one of the aging, but I think one or two maybe in need. So anyway, one printer. And that includes a, for fiscal year 20, includes 2% increase, as was approved. So let's see, this will go before town meeting in April. Each department's budget.
And it has yet to be approved by
me. Correct. Correct. The 2% increase, I think, was, you know, that was the other councils on aging reach out to one another saying, how much has your town, you know, included in your budget for this year? 1%, 1.5%, 2.5%. We landed at 2%. So let's see if that's approved. And as to the question about badges and IDs, I like that idea very much. I think that's a great idea.
For
friendly visitors, for outreach.
So we don't do that now?
We don't. It is a good idea. Janet Delmar and I have talked about, she's the outreach case manager, taking a photo and doing a laminated card.
We used to have those.
Volunteers did, right? In other words, there was a camera, there was a Polaroid,
yeah,
a big camera.
Because I never remember doing it, but I've got my picture.
Right.
And you clip it on the clothes, and right. So it's going to be council on aging.
And we've talked about using lanyards. So we can have.
I just wondered.
It is a good
when
idea.
When someone went to Van Home. Yeah.
It is a good idea. What we've done is introduce a person. I've gone out a couple of times, someone who might be familiar with me, before just sending somebody on hold. Janet has a new friendly visitor, a volunteer, so she's going out on each of the visits with the clients who are already familiar with her to introduce.
And if you have their email, you could always email over a picture with an ID.
Right. Certainly to families, it's a good idea. But I think we've already put lanyards in the Staples cart. So. And now we don't need the enormous camera. We can do this with something. So. The last question, with five board members, if one is absent, if we don't have. Or if we don't have a quorum, if there's a tie and a vote. Did Emmett address that? Emmett Schmarsow?
No, but he said, he had said something about we should have a number, and I just said, I'm out of trouble. What happens if you vote? What, just curious, what happens? Not that we're an honorary bunch or anything like that.
That is an interesting point, though, I'll have to ask. I did hear back from the town clerk that teleconferencing has been voted on and approved.
Oh, good.
In the past, so somewhat recently. So
I asked Susan, and she said, yeah, there's some kind of law that it's okay. And I don't know how we should do that. Should I call someone's cell?
Right, that's the thing. How should we do
there
that?
I don't think there's a speakerphone in here, right?
No. All right, so the practicality of that, we'll have to figure that out.
I'm not a technical assistant.
Right.
Well, I know that you can just call.
You can just use
a
cell phone. Right, and put it underneath the table.
Right. I don't know if anyone's willing to do that.
Oh, sure.
That's fine for me.
You'd have to have an extension to have it charge you, so we'd have to be prepared, so.
Yeah.
Well, we could absolutely do that.
Yeah.
Just make sure your phone is charged up.
I was going to say, make sure your phone is charged and signal is good in this building and Wi-Fi is good in this building.
So. All right, so we shall call you.
Sure. That works. That's great. Yeah, I just heard back from him today, so that's nice.
Good.
So I will.
That way I can still do the minutes.
Right.
Still. Somebody will have to print them, but I can still do it.
It's fine. I can print the minutes out. That works. And I will inquire about a tie vote. Because it is an interesting.
Yeah, I'm assuming it would probably just be table till the next meeting.
Oh,
when they're going to do the other board member.
Unless it was some emergent.
Never had the need for a tie vote. So
you said I like the word ornering. Yeah, I don't know if I heard it. Let's go to my address. What is it at the moment? We have two new property tax workoff volunteer applications in the process. And we may end up with a COA. End up somewhere else. The COA, we still have some needs. We could still use another friendly visitor. So, yes. And one newish volunteer who is going to help out occasionally with things like luncheons. That's what I wanted to bring up. I think I may have mentioned Triton, having reached out. Two different groups at Triton reaching out for intergenerational programming. One of them is the Life Skills, and it's got more to the title, Life Skills Program for Students 18 to 22, special ed students. They're interested in doing grocery shopping for senior residents. They're going to start with the COA, doing grocery shopping, and program director called it an audition, doing lunch prep. That's one of the other life skills they're trying to foster. Food prep, chopping, food safe practices for the students. I think it's six or seven students. So they'll be doing that in the next month, perhaps before we meet again. And so we're looking at that to offer to some seniors who are more homebound, who can't take advantage of the van for grocery shopping. And we'll be, through town council, we'll have a form for residents to sign that protects the council image and the town. All of the students in the program would be working one-on-one with a teacher to pick up a grocery list, go do the grocery shopping, pick up the list with cash, go do the grocery shopping, and then counting out change, doing all that as a piece of the training, and then returning back with the groceries. So.
And they have transportation?
Yes.
Yes.
And then the second program is through a community liaison to do more, a bit broader intergenerational activities, starting with shoveling this winter. As I say that, I'm going to knock on our veneer here that doesn't snow, to shovel. So for each of the three communities, Salisbury, Raleigh, and Newbury, and I think they're, at last count, we're about 11 volunteers. Would be, I think it's mostly high school students and their families, to do a path at the very least. You know, they wouldn't necessarily do an entire driveway, it's very long, but a path for people who receive services who may not have snow removal set up, or for whom that's difficult financially. So that will also have a form for residents to sign.
And these people find out this program's available, how?
We would be reaching out to people who don't live in the senior communities.
Mm-hmm.
Don't have family close by.
Okay.
And they have about 11 volunteers, so it's not an enormous.
Right,
it's not 100 people.
That's a good idea.
It's a nice idea. Reach out to them and introduce the program. Let them know that a person named Bob Jones will be calling,
mm-hmm,
to make arrangements with you.
Needs.
There is, we don't actually receive a lot of calls for it, which is interesting. There was someone who I think used to do a few senior residents' driveways who moved to Florida. I think this is 2 years ago. So we received a few calls saying that my guy moved. No one has snow plowing services, but we don't keep a list of those services.
I think that's important to have success with a program like this, because so many things have dropped because of lack of interest. And you know, that 11 volunteers will double next year. Are they going to be available like for summer jobs too?
I don't know. I think this is kind of the to test, test the water, see how this goes over. So as soon as we receive the document from town council, we have a few names, four or five names, that we'll start with. And we may add to that. A lot of the names are coming from Janet, the outreach case manager. Because she has a good idea as to whether anybody, a resident has anyone nearby to help out. So we'll let you know how this goes.
And for the February meeting, do we want it on the 11th or 25th? Because of the holiday.
Does anyone have any preference? I would say the
25th.
25th?
Okay. All right. If we do it on the 25th, I just need to make like 1:30 instead of 1 o'clock. Okay. Call the meeting closed at 2:02.
And Sandy, I will send my phone number.